You teach us.
Teach us to fight for the weak, to see those in need, and move into impossible, uncomfortable, unreachable.
If you have a voice tonight,
teach us to love like you do, to move how you move into the impossible, uncomfortable, unreachable.
Won't you teach us?
Teach us to fight for the weak, to see those in need, and move into impossible.
Good evening, Praxis. Please stand with us as we sing. Whatever this week brought you, I just pray that you would take the words of this song and let God give you strength and infuse courage in your heart. Let's sing now. Three.
Strength. strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the
to Praxis. I'm Annie.
I'm Jessica.
And as you can see, we are unintentionally matching tonight, but we do want to do a couple announcements tonight. But first, before we do that, I want you to turn to your neighbor and ask, what is your favorite Sabbath memory? Something that's relaxing, whether it was with your family, whether it was with friends, and
yeah, and you guys can sit down for this unless you feel like standing. And also, if you never celebrated Sabbath before and you don't have a Sabbath memory, think about when was the last time that you did something restful? So that's part two of the question.
Take a moment. We'll be back in a minute. We're coming back for a minute. As you guys wrap up, hopefully you guys have had wonderful, relaxing memories, and if not, there's time to make more memories. But to continue on for our announcements, we have improv night. I don't know if any of you guys have done improv, but it's actually one of the most interesting things to do. I feel like you are just always on. You have to be on. You have to figure out things. But we're going to be having improv night tomorrow at Azure Hills. They're going to be having music, laughs. We're basically, they're going to be actors that create scenes on the story based on prompts, based on people calling things out. And it's just going to be like a lot of fun, you know, bring family, bring friends along. We're going to be having it tomorrow at 7 p.m. in Azure Hills Church. And hope to see you guys there. I think it's going to be a really fun event.
And then speaking of interesting things to do, there will be the You Reach Renew Clinic tomorrow afternoon at Crosswalk Church. So I don't know if any of you guys have ever gone to that before, but if you haven't, it will be from 2 to 4 p.m. So come out, bring your friends, and what it is it's a time to show support and love to the unhoused community in our area. So there will be food and clothing stations and also shower and hygiene stations that they'll need volunteers at. So if you don't have plans for tomorrow afternoon, 2 to 4 p.m., Crosswalk Church, Renew Clinic.
Awesome. And I just want to see a show of hands. How many of you guys have been to our Praxis Sabbath School? Raise your hands. Wow, amazing. So this is, number one, our invite for you guys to go. We have it every Saturday morning, Sabbath morning at 10 a.m. It's going to be downstairs in the Praxis room where they're going to be have afterglow. And it's just a lot of time to discuss and really get together in small groups, discuss whatever the topic is of the week. And one of my favorite things that I love about it is the teachers. I don't know if you guys have gotten the chance to experience all the different kinds of teachers we have, but we're also looking for more teachers. This is a great time to step up, to kind of also challenge yourself to be a better Sabbath school teacher. And this is a time where you're gonna have support all the way around. And for those of you who do want to be there, who don't want to facilitate, we're going to be having a meeting next Friday after night church. It's only going to be about 20 to 30 minutes. Take some time, think about it. If you want to be a facilitator, if you want to be more involved, this is your chance to do so.
Okay. And without asking for a show of hands for whoever has ever played softball, if you've never played but you'd like to learn how to play, or you're an enthusiast and you want to cheer everybody on, the Praxis Rooted softball game that was previously scheduled back in February has now been rescheduled for towards the end of this month. So April 21, save the date. It will be at Loma Linda Academy, LLA, just right down the street from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. on Sunday, April 21. And then after that, there will be a brunch at one of the leaders' houses. And so if you're interested, save the date. And Kelly will email out the address if you sign up for that event.
And finally, we really want to thank each and every one of you for being here. You have a reason for being here. And we are not only thankful to see your beautiful faces, but we are thankful for your support as well. So we want to hopefully have a wonderful rest of the evening and allow God into our lives. And we want to pray for you guys throughout the night.
We invite everybody to stand up and worship.
Fortune lies beyond the stars. There's dazzling heights too fast to climb. I got so high to fall so far, but I found heaven as love swept through my heart beating, my soul. Thank you. too long. I'm here to bring you home. Yes, I am. I'll reach. I'll chase you down. I dare you to believe how much I love you now. Sing it with me. Don't be afraid. I am your strength. We'll be walking.
Every star, set every star into place. friends, I want you to take a thoughtful moment with Jesus in prayer actually right now. I want you to take a moment to actually turn, potentially if you're comfortable with it, to turn to the two or three people around you. I want you to have a special moment with Jesus together and just share a burden that's on your heart. It doesn't have to be much that you say. Just pray for this, or maybe a silent request. Invite someone next to you, or maybe you want to just pray alone, and that's okay too. But take 1 minute to do that right now with two or three people next to you, and just have a holy moment with you and the Lord. So would you do that right now? Those of you watching online, we want to encourage you to take a moment too to pray to Jesus and share anything that's in your heart that you might have. We love you, we care for you, and we pray that God would feed your mind and soul. And so take a moment right now to pray with those around you. Amazing God, thank you so much, Jesus, for being the Father who steps in the midst of our burdens. And you say, take it all to me. I can hold it, not only with you in this moment, but with everyone in the world. Jesus, we want to lay these burdens at your feet and say, God, do what only you can do. Give us a heart of patience if we need to wait. Give us a heart of expectation to believe again that you can do the great things that your word has declared through the miracles of the Bible. Maybe some of us just need to continue to persevere in prayer. And so, Lord, give us a heart of courage and resilience. Tonight, we know that many have walked in this place, maybe with a little bit of an anxious heart, maybe some with exhaustion, maybe some with expectation. However we've come in this place, Jesus, we want to say, come and meet with us. Rest in our hearts. Draw us near to your throne of grace. Shower us with a multitude of blessings that we never even considered. Father, I pray that you would speak through my brother David tonight as he shares your word through the story of Babel in the Bible. And God, we also want to just pray a prayer of thanks. Thank you for stepping into the spaces that we didn't even know you were there. God, we want to praise you for our health that we have. We want to praise you for the blessings that are around us. And Lord, thank you for saving us. And Lord, we thank you also that you're coming back again. In Jesus' name, all God's people said, amen, amen, amen. Thank you, friends. Well, we continue our act of worship and giving right now. I want to give you a big thank you as a ministry. We have been faithfully meeting all of our financial goals as a Praxis leadership team. It means so much to me as a pastor that young adults are taking that extra step to say, hey, it's not my parents' church anymore, it's mine. It's my church. And so those of you who have been faithful and you're giving both in tithes and offerings to the main church and but also supporting other ministries like Praxis, I just want to tell you thank you. So if you have a QR code that's in front of you on your phone, just pull that out. You can place a little dollar or some more, 10, 20, maybe you got 100 on you, some of you. Put it in if you can. But thank you so much for your faithfulness. It means so much. Ministry happens by your giving. So thank you for that. This next thing that I'm going to share about is a pretty exciting opportunity that the North American Division, partnering with Australia Hope Channel, has actually produced an amazing film telling the story of Adventism. And it's done through the eyes of Jay and N. Andrews. I don't know however many of you maybe went to the school that I did, which was named after this missionary of the 19th century named John Nevins Andrews. And he and his family tried to actually evangelize all the way in Europe. They were some of the first Adventist missionaries into Europe. And along the way, this movie that was produced that's now going to be in theaters this week, 17th and 18th, you can go on our church website and click on one of the tabs talking about the film called The Hopeful. And this is telling the early Adventist story of these Adventist pioneers who were hopeful that Jesus would come and the story of kind of how our church was birthed. So it's a really incredible opportunity. It's going to be in movie theaters all across America only on Wednesday and Thursday. There were some of you that clicked on our Instagram. You could have come to the premiere that is being done in Hollywood, Los Angeles area this Monday. But for those of you who missed out on that, you can still buy tickets to come see The Hopeful on Wednesday or Thursday anywhere across Southern California. There's showings in the AMC, Tyler Mall, different ones around Yucaipa, Beaumont, just all over. And so I hope you go online and take a look to buy tickets to see the film. We're going to actually look at the trailer. It's 2 minutes. I just want you to get a little bit inspired what our Adventist creatives are doing. And this is just one storytelling of how creatives take the gospel all over the world. And so take a look at the trailer for The Hopeful right now.
Obey his word and believe. There is no time for delay.
I believe the Bible is clear. Jesus will return in but 4 short years.
I come before you today to tell you that I have been shown in vision.
Father Miller's message was light. The Advent people were traveling on a path toward a bright and holy city.
This is not the first time the end of the world has been prophesied by a fool, nor will it be the last. If you do not renounce these radical ideas, you will not be welcome here in this house of worship.
This was only the beginning of our journey.
Her visions do not come from God.
But my friends, she speaks with great tenderness of the word of the Lord.
The Holy Spirit encouraged our Advent hope. There were people who didn't listen and they fell off the path.
You really believe this doctrine which you preach? I was lost, and now I'm found.
We must follow the word of God over the rule of men. We feel love. The love of Jesus. It lifts us up. It carries us forward. And it will guide us home.
I was made for you.
So, friends, I hope you take an opportunity to check online and maybe bring a friend of yours. You can have a conversation about Adventism. Some of you maybe are brand new to this whole idea of Christianity even, so you might have to do a little bit more storytelling. But I hope that you might consider going to the theaters and watching that this week. Well, friends, with no further ado, I want to give you an opportunity to connect with Jesus through the Word. We really believe in that here at Praxis at the University Church. The gospel is proclaimed through God's people studying the Word of God. And tonight, with a grateful expectation, we finish our series, which has been such a blessing by our elder team. And so I want to just encourage you to open up your heart as we might consider one more trust issue, retold now by my good brother and one of our elders here at the University Church, David Zarka. We got to meet each other all the way back in Hungary some years ago when I got to speak there. And then I get a tap on my shoulder as I'm teaching Sabbath School. And he says, "Philip, hey, you remember me." And so it's been such a blessing to have David here at our church. What a joy it is to hear from you tonight as God speaks to you. So open up your hearts to God's word as we study one more trust issue.
Well, hello everyone. How's it going? It's good to see you all here. Happy Sabbath. It's such a blessing to come and worship here with you every Friday. And man, what a journey this series has been. And also, it's wonderful how God like moves in the things that have been unplanned. I just want you to remember the last two songs that we sang. We had a couple words, walking on the water, dancing on the waves, and then also remember the lyrics of what a friend we have in Jesus. My name is David. I'm one of the elders here, as Philip has mentioned. And before we begin, let's bow our heads in a word of prayer. Father, we invite you here with your Holy Spirit, with your Son, to dwell among us right now. Let us feel your presence, and let us not see me or hear me, but only your words and your presence may be felt. Lord, someone here needs a blessing today, and we just ask that you give me the words that I need to speak so that I can speak into the lives of those people. Please touch our hearts. We are open to your influence, and we welcome your presence here, both in our lives and in this church here today. Amen. She started her journey on the 10th of April, and she was supposed to arrive 7 days later. Now, it's the age of possibilities. Hope was the common language, and prosperity was the banner under which every nation united. The world was at peace, the economy was booming, and mankind ruled the world with new inventions, allowing them to achieve what they've never been able to do before. What a day to be alive. Everybody was amazed at her beauty and potential. She was the symbol that everybody looked up to and celebrated. 100,000 people came to see her off when she began her journey westward, and there was no limit to what she could achieve. From the very beginning, she received the best care possible. The most respected and accomplished professionals tended to her and ensured that she will be fully prepared for anything. Nothing could take her down or stop her. And what a sight she was to behold in the harbor of Southampton, England. The Titanic was indeed colossal, almost 900 feet long, To give you reference, that's about like a 75-story skyscraper. So if you go in the middle of LA, she would fit in perfectly. She was capable of carrying 3,500 passengers and crew along with cargo, and that made her the largest vessel of her time. The mighty engines had a combined output of 30,000 horsepower. Now your car will have about 150, most likely. Well, she came with a saltwater swimming pool, a gym, a squash court, sorry, no pickleball here at this time, a Victorian-style Turkish bath, and she looked like the Ritz on the inside, which made the passengers believe they were floating on a luxurious hotel, losing the feeling that they were on a ship. Passengers could enjoy authentic Italian cuisine at the a la carte restaurant, or enjoy the delicacies of the Café Parisien, or even the Veranda Café, which had a grand view of the endless ocean. The pride Thomas Andrews, the Titanic's chief naval architect, would have felt when he saw his creation bustling with life, with the most prominent passengers on board, captained by the White Star Line's finest, Captain Edward Smith at the helm, the seasoned leader of the Olympic, which was the Titanic's older sister. The passengers also believed that they were either living the dream or they were on the way to live their dream. The ship carried some of the wealthiest people of society, and people from all over the world came just so that they could say that they sailed on the largest ship ever made. They were proud to be among those, these people, of the first and second class, but you also had people in the third class. And they also were living their new adventure, most likely from all over Europe, heading towards the U.S. or Canada, to live that dream, to search for that better life, the siren call of those unlimited opportunities. But not every room looked like it was taken from the Louvre. The 700 third-class passengers were inspected at the beginning for any ailments or physical impairments that might lead to them not being accepted, refused entry to the United States, which was an inconvenience to the White Star Line, which the company that owned the Titanic, it wanted to avoid. But if only she could have been stopped. But who could see it coming, really? The best of the best worked on the project. They had systems in place. They thought of a contingency plan for everything. Technology gave them all the answers that they were seeking, and they were amused by the luxury that they created. They had no reason whatsoever to doubt themselves or feel the need to trust in something much higher than themselves. They were running towards a future that glorified themselves, one that placed corporations, massive technological monstrosities, and wealth in the center of their lives. Now, there's a story in the Old Testament where people did something quite similar. They put trust in themselves. They united under their own banner, where they ran towards their own values and ideals, rather than trusting God's visible promises. This happened a little after the cataclysmic event that almost wiped every single bit of life off the place of the face of the earth. So if you have your Bibles or if you have your phones ready, turn with me to Genesis chapter 11. We'll read from the very first verse. It's just the first few. And we begin in verse number 1 in Genesis chapter 11. Now, the whole world had one language and a common speech. As people moved eastward, they found a plain in Shinar and settled there. They said to each other, "Come, let's make bricks and bake them thoroughly." They used brick instead of stone and bitumen for mortar. Then they said, "Come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens, so that we may make a name for ourselves. Otherwise, we will be scattered over the face of the whole earth." Now, I did a quick search on these building materials, and I found it actually quite interesting. So these people, I think, were actually quite clever. First of all, using brick was, number one, much cheaper and much easier to use, especially when you're building something as magnificent as the tower that they wanted to do. But it's the bitumen where I actually found stuff to get very interesting. Bitumen is a black, sticky substance that is used either as an adhesive or for waterproofing. It is the byproduct of burning wood or coal. And you can guess who in the Bible also used the same material to waterproof things. Just a few chapters before that, it was Noah. Noah, who used that material to waterproof the ark. So to prevent water to enter into inside the hull of the ship. So these people were also fresh off the ark, so to speak. The collective memory of the flood, it lingered in the air. And although God had promised to never destroy the whole world again in a flood, and you know, for that reason he instituted the rainbow, it was actually intended to remind the people of God's mercy and not God himself that he was to exercise restraint. But as I'm sure you've heard it said that two are better than one, they're not just better at improving things, they're also better at messing things up. So what happens when an entire society comes together, united under one single idea? What happens when people unite in that way? They trusted their own idolized abilities. And maybe you're not going to be surprised if we mention that Shinar is another name for Babylonia. It's in that same place. And just like Nebuchadnezzar, they wanted to erect a city that upheld their name. They resented the idea of being a footnote in history somewhere, forgotten. That was too painful for their egos to imagine. They misinterpreted the character of God because they allowed themselves not just to doubt, but to actively mistrust his intentions. And if you couple that with ambition, which they definitely had, there could be no limit to what they could and possibly would do. Let's get back to the Titanic for a minute. It all happened on the 15th of April, almost at midnight. A Monday that's going to be exactly 112 years ago. They already traveled for the past 3 days without much issue, at least nothing that they couldn't handle with ease. As they were approaching this specific time and location, they received a bunch of warnings from ships that already have gone past that place in the past few days. But they decided to ignore those warnings. The Titanic was going to make its own path. Captain Smith is quoted to say that he could not imagine any condition which would cause a ship to founder. Modern shipbuilding had gone beyond that. So the Titanic went full steam ahead. They were intent on making a name for themselves. They were not going to go into the footnotes of history. And at around 11:40 p.m., so just a few minutes before midnight, Frederick Fleet, he was the lookout on the Titanic. He spotted an iceberg straight ahead of them. But that was far too late for the Titanic to course correct, because whenever they tried out to come to a full stop, it took them a little bit more than 3 minutes with their engines. And as the Titanic rammed into the iceberg, it punctured several holes into the hull beneath the waterline. 5 of the 16 watertight compartments were heavily breached, and one was slightly compromised. And it did not take them long to realize that the ship could not continue with more than 4 of these compartments being fully filled with water. And as the ship began to sink bow first, so at the very front, the terrified passengers realized that they had to fend for themselves. Many of the crew members were actually not trained sailors. They were people just hired a week before the ship set sail. They quickly found out that there was no evacuation plan that the crew was trained in. People rushed to the lifeboats, but there was only enough for half of those on board. If the ship would have been at full capacity, which it wasn't, there were only 2,200 passengers on the ship with crew included, but if they would have been 3,500 with crew, they would have only had lifeboats for only a third of the people on board. This is actually a decision that White Star Line, the company that owned the Titanic, made. They were first going to put 48 lifeboats on the ship, which would have been sufficient for everyone, but they decided to reduce that number to just 20 because, come on, who is going to need that? And on top of that, the officers did not really know exactly what it is, like how many people they could fit on a lifeboat. So many of the boats were actually launched barely half full. In those days, the protocol was women and children first. So most of the male passengers and crew members were left aboard. The survival rates among women was 75%, with 50% for children, and only 20% of men. And the evacuation, of course, favored those on the first and second class. Many of them, especially women and children, survived. But not so much for the third class. They were mostly left to care for themselves, whatever that means. Even the chief architect, the chief naval architect, and the captain went down with that same ship. It was brilliant in design and years in work, and with a sprinkling of hubris, it resulted in 1,500 lives lost, and 700 being scarred by that unparalleled trauma of the day. If only she could have been stopped. This is what can happen when you replace God with either self or humanity or technology or prosperity or glory or anything else. Who needs God when you can plan for every contingency? It was believed that not even God could sink that ship. Now, the builders of the Tower of Babel also thought that there was nothing that could stop them. So let's pick up in Genesis in verse 5 and where we left off to see how God responds to this story and how that changes an impending tragedy. Verse 5, but the Lord came down to see the city and the tower the people were building. The Lord said, If as one people speaking the same language, they have begun to do this, then nothing they plan to do will be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language, so they will not understand each other. So the Lord scattered them from there over all the earth, and they stopped building the city. This is why it was called Babel, because there the Lord confused their language of the whole world. From there, the Lord scattered them over the face of the whole world. See, I wonder what would have happened if God did not stop them. Imagine a world where there is no limit to the evil humanity can think of. There are no borders. There are no barriers. There are no language or cultural barriers. It was not the tower that was the real issue, because the tower itself was harmless. It was the desire to grow, the desire to rebuild. That too was also harmless. They were coming from this cataclysmic event of the flood. Their ambition and their desire to survive and their desire to grow, to increase civilization, that was all good. So what was wrong? It was the intention that fueled everything behind that. The people refused to disperse over the face of the earth as God wanted them to fill the land, because his idea was to fill the land with life all over again, because it had been wiped just a little while ago. So this is what he told Noah to do after the ark had settled, so everyone knew that this was what God wanted them to do. but they refused to obey because they distrusted his might and his will. And they started to build their future on this distrust, which began to unlock the limitless potential of evil, which resulted in abounding atrocities before the flood that gave God no other choice but to wipe them out entirely. Now, God knew that humanity will most likely follow along this same exact path if he was going to allow them to do it. If there was no boundary to what they could do, and if they could achieve anything that they set their minds and their hearts to, like with that tower, then absolutely nothing will change. They have already demonstrated this in their own way, as they explicitly distrusted God's promise. Instead of dispersing, they stayed in one place and decided to rebuild together. And he had to do something because he promised to never destroy the whole world again. So how is he going to keep his promise to keep them alive? So it all happened in an instant. Total confusion. They were in the middle of something, and then all of a sudden, teljes lett az űrzavar. Senki nem értett semmit. Hiába beszéltek egymásnak, hiába ismételték el magukat, hiába magyarázták el megint, a másik meg sem értette őket. Mindenki össze-vissza hadovált. Az sem segített, ha hangosabban beszéltek. Oh, you didn't understand me. Ah, that must have been because I spoke to you in Hungarian. See, just to give you a little golden tidbit so that you all have something to walk away from here today. Hungarian, some say, and I haven't been able to prove this otherwise, but Hungarian is going to be the language of heaven because it takes an eternity to learn. So I really apologize, Spanish speakers. Some of you were led to believe otherwise, but hence, this is the cruel truth that we will have to deal with. Find me in heaven and I will teach you gladly. But imagine the frustration. Nobody understood anything the others were saying. Were they even aware that they were speaking in different languages? Because all they knew was that they continued speaking, and then all of a sudden, nothing made sense anymore. No part could carry on because the instructions that they were waiting for or the corrections they were supposed to receive were undecipherable. So the things that were asked for were just not being done. Total chaos. They were stopped dead in their tracks. So were you ever stopped before by God? Like conspiracy level stopped? When you did everything in your power when the ball was in your court, but for some external factor, unforeseen reason, things did not allow you to move forward. Maybe you've set your mind on a career path. Because you wanted the stability and the security it provides. Maybe you pursued a girl who had all the personality traits you thought you wanted that made you guys compatible. Maybe the guy you were interested in had the kind of future already lined up that you've always been dreaming of. Or maybe you found yourself a group of people who you wanted to become friends with because they just always seemed to live their best life. They always did all the fun stuff, especially when you compare their lives to everyone else, maybe even yours. But why did you run towards that choice? Were you running to fulfill your own agenda, or were you running from something else? You see, the builders of the Tower of Babel were terrified because they thought God was after them. So, were you maybe running towards that comfortable career because right now you feel like God has put you in a desert and forgotten about you? Or maybe if you hang in there, you will find yourself in a place where you are actually able to make a real difference. And what if the personality traits that you thought you wanted in a girl were not the one you needed in a partner? What if you're only running to them because you've had a tough breakup and you just want a relationship to be easy and you don't want someone who challenges you to grow and to have the image of Christ get ever clearer within you? What if you ran towards that guy because he could provide financially, but in reality, he cannot provide a safe space for you where you feel protected and where you feel cherished? What if fitting into that specific group of people would have caused you to bend the values that you were raised on, causing you to become a different person altogether? Thank you, Kelly. And sometimes you don't know why you have been stopped until you just go through that life experience. And I've been stopped before too. I remember being bewildered after my first breakup. I initially imagined that I was supposed to marry the first person I ever dated, and I imagined that we just have to like force this relationship to happen, no matter the effect the dynamic has on both of us. We were not the blessings to each other that we would have needed to be. It was just not meant to be. But I still remember feeling like my entire world was collapsing, that I was utterly confused. And it was then that my dad told me, we're actually driving in the car, and he turned back to me and said, "You know, David, sometimes God saves us from the mistakes we are willing to make." Wow. Let me say that again for Philip's sake. Sometimes God saves us from the mistakes we are willing to make. Our mistake is not wanting something better. It's not the ambition. It's not wanting that better life. It's by trusting ourselves or the vision that we have for our lives more than the unknown plans that God has for us. So what an act of mercy. Thank God that the builders of the Tower of Babel were stopped. Thank God that we've been stopped before. If only we could be stopped all the time we're about to do something foolish, when we don't know what we're getting into. So after Babel, because there is a life after Babel, people proceeded to fill the earth again. They dispersed, just like God intended, tending nature, spreading order, civilization, and sowing the seeds of the world that we know today. And God continued to watch over them, keeping his promise to never wipe out all life on earth again. And it is from this future that he called those faithful to him to be a blessing to the further generations. You see, there is growth and future for us, even after we have been stopped by God. We have our own agenda that sometimes does not come from a holy vision, but one that needs to be baptized. And baptized by trials and tribulations even, allowing us to reevaluate the vision and realign with God's vision for our best. We find value in the friends who lead us in the correct direction, the partner who sharpens us like iron sharpens iron, the career that brings meaning to the sacrifices we make inevitably for any kind of work. So we're finishing now our series on trust issues. Who do you relate to? Do you find yourself feeling close to Eve, perhaps, who did not trust God's judgment call on what is right and what is wrong and did not trust his love? Or do we relate more to Adam, who struggled with the thought of losing companionship or with being alone? Or to their child Cain, who could not believe that God was greater than his failure? Or Noah, who wanted the easy way out and escape from reality? unsure how God will navigate the silence of new beginnings? Or does the influence of our current society make us succumb to the ideas that we are better stewards of our future than God is? So whatever your story, I invite you to hold on to God. Your desires, your motivations, and your ambition must be baptized and occasionally realigned with God's vision for your life. This change usually happens when everything else grinds to a halt and God stops you dead in your tracks. That, of course, feels like a total tragedy when you're in it. But the real tragedy is when that does not happen. And while I cannot tell you exactly what it is that you need to do in your story, I can say from experience that the only thing, the simplest answer to this complicated question is, the only clean way out of this chaos really is to have that close personal connection with Jesus. Because we see him emerge victorious from all of the traps and uncertainties that he met in the New Testament. Why? It was because he ran back to the Father with every single question and heartache. Invite him into your life amidst this chaos. And let him stop you and even course correct you. And that personal connection you build through the journey will rebuild your trust in him. And afterwards, when you look back, you will be able to identify the titanic tragedies in your life that never happened.
Right. Thank you, David. Just invite you to stand with us as we sing this last song. It's called Build My Life. And, you know, the people of the Tower of Babel tried to build something on their own. And I just pray that it would be our prayer that we would build our lives on Christ, on Jesus. So let's sing.
Now, worthy of every breath we could ever.
out one more time, just the voices. Sing holy.
Holy.
There is no
seated. In Proverbs 3 verse 5 says, trust in your Lord with all your heart, lean not on your own understanding. The reason why I love this verse is because it also adds to the elders series of the trust series, and I'm kind of sad that it's over. And David, I want to thank you for the sermon that you had. And guys, a couple announcements we have for you guys. After I'm done speaking, we'll have our prayer team led by Phoebe here. And she's going to be here right in the stage. If you guys have any burdens, or if you want to pray for someone, or if you have anything on your heart, I invite you guys, encourage you guys to come up here. And on top of that, guys, we're doing baptism. Kelly, Phil, and I, we're leading baptism for anyone interested in trying to get closer to God. We're talking about trust here, and we want to be closer to God. We want to trust in God with all of our hearts. All the glory goes to Him, none to ourselves. Amen? And so, guys, if you guys want to get closer to God, please, please, I encourage you guys to come to Kelly or Phil. Phil, Kelly, raise your hand. They're right there. Their hands are raised on the right side. And, guys, next I have, if you guys want to join us in Afterglow. Afterglow is basically a time and place where we can just decompress and meet friends, meet new people. I see a lot of new faces here, and this is a great thing. There's a lot of new faces I've never seen here. And guys, if you guys come with us in the basement where we have Afterglow, meet someone new. And for those who've been here for a while, please encourage and just welcome them with the spirit of hospitality and encourage them to come again every single Friday night. And guys, Sabbath School will be led by Kelly. Sabbath School will start at 10 a.m. also in the basement. The traditional service and anthem will be at... The traditional service will be at 9 a.m. and 11:45 a.m. And anthem will be at 10 a.m. and 11:30 a.m. And guys, U-Reach, do we have the slide of U-Reach? If we can bring that up here. U-Reach, we encourage you guys to come. It's every second Saturday. It's all behind me right here. On the top left, there's a QR code. If you guys want to be involved, I highly encourage you guys to get involved. The QR code is up there, 2 to 4 p.m. every second Saturday. And lastly, next weekend, we're going to have a night of testimonies where we'll have a panel of people telling their testimonies on how their lives changed. And I really encourage you guys come tonight, next weekend. And guys, you might not know everyone here, and that's totally fine. But I encourage you guys to at least know one new person here and just make them feel comfortable. And with that being said, guys, I dismiss you guys down to Afterglow. Thank you. Thank you.